One Piece Clockwork Island Adventure Review. This movie is the second One Piece movie to ever be released, and I just want to talk about the plot a little bit first. So the Mary gets stolen, and one of my main gripes with the movie is that while they were hanging out on the beach, Zoro had left his sword on the Mary, Usopp had left his slingshot on the Mary, Nami appeared to have left her staff on the Mary, and Usopp left his slingshot there, and Sanji left his combat to the shoes he wears when he fights on the Mary. So the only person there that can fight at full capacity is Luffy. And I have a major problem with that, because that makes it in a way where Luffy does mostly all the cool stuff in this movie. And also I have major problems with what they did with Nami's character in this movie, but that's for later. But so they get on this like little dinghy, and they barely fit. It's actually really funny. They're wearing really cheap clothes that they bought. Nami wearing this like really ugly, like really cheap looking wedding dress. Sanji wearing a suit that it looks like he got out of the garbage. Zoro wearing some like banged up, torn kimono, and Luffy just wearing the same thing, and the same cake with Usopp. Now, they meet a guy that has a kid with him. The man's name is Baruto, I believe his name is Baridi? Baruto? I don't call him Baruto. But his name is like Baruto or something along those lines. And the kid's name is Akin, I believe. Or something like Aki, his name is. Yeah. So they meet the kid, and they're told, and then they mention, and while they're talking and interacting, they mention their ship had been stolen. And, you know, the guys are like, well, we have an idea. And then it gets revealed, they think they are told that the ones that stole it were none other than the main villains of the film, who you will not believe the name of the pirate crew that the Straw Hats go up against in this movie. If it wasn't for the time period I was watching this in, it would not be considered a pro. So note that I'm recording this in the United States of America in 2016. Okay, you ready? The name of the pirate crew is the Trump Pirate. The Trump Pirate. Yeah, that got me. I was laughing. I found that absolutely hilarious. But pretty much what happens is that the guys attack the Straw. The guys, they come up and they pretty much like a typical stereotypical antagonist are about to attack, but before they attack, they ask about a riddle, and they're like, who will be the king of the pirates, or the pirate king? And Luffy's like, me. And they're like, wrong answer. And then they attack. When they're about to attack, Luffy's like, no, it's the right answer. Which, it was really good. Really good. The voice acting is on point in this, unlike in the last one. But, so they fight off the guy. Sanji, because he's not wearing his shoes, and considering one of the henchmen's abilities, I don't remember these people's names, because they're given not really any personality, no backstory, they're not very interesting. But he has like a spike devil fruit that allows him to like turn into a ball and like make spikes come out of his body. So when Sanji goes to kick him, the spike will like go through his foot, he'll get like hurt. And when he kicks things, his feet like get messed up. So in this movie, I guess they're really trying to push the fact that Sanji needs his shoes for combat. Now, of course, that is no longer the case in the manga or the anime due to armament hockey being introduced, but that is beside the point. So Sanji, for the majority of the movie, is 100% useless. But speaking of useless, Zoro doesn't have his sword, but he still has physical strength, so he does use some hand-to-hand combat a little bit in this movie, which is very interesting to see. Usopp is just as useful as normal, and Luffy just does what Luffy normally does. But let's talk about why the Straw Hats end up engaging this enemy. So the two main henchmen of the Trump Pirate destroy the friend of Baruto and Akin. They destroy their ship, I mean. And so the Straw Hats need to retreat, so they're all getting on this thing. And one of the henchmen, this woman, kidnapped Nami. Yeah, and then she's wearing a wedding dress, so I think you can kind of guess where this is going. It actually tried to do something interesting within it, but it doesn't work. But then they take Nami to Clockwork Island. Luffy is just like, okay, we gotta get Nami back. And he had also, for some reason, gave Nami his hat while he fought these weak henchmen. I don't know why he did that. I guess that was just really, there was no reason for it. I don't know why. Like, they wanted Luffy to not wear his hat the entire movie. Because he literally only wore his hat for the first, like, 15 minutes. Because Nami, they didn't rescue Nami until the very end of the movie, so he didn't get that thing back until the very end. And I had a major problem with that. That really annoyed me because he's Straw Hat Luffy. But whatever. And by the way, in case you're wondering, this is post Arlong Park, but it appears to be pre-Logtown. So yeah. But it's interesting, but there's a couple holes in it. When we find out Boruto and Aki, or whatever his name is, are brothered, but not brothered by blood, kind of like Luffy and Ace. But of course, it never elaborated on. We thought at this time, I don't know if Ace was even introduced yet. All I know is that at this point in time, that Ace, in connection with Luffy, would have been believed to be biological brothers, according to the manga. However, the thing where things get weird. So they get to the island, and Luffy, any concern they had for Nami just disappeared. Now, Luffy, I somewhat buy it. They're trying to play the whole he's very stupid and naive. Like, he's just looking at everything like it's a game. They're trying to play that card. I sort of get it. But Sanji doesn't care about Nami. Usopp doesn't care. And Zoro doesn't care. But eventually they meet the couple, and it was really weird. They pretty much just told them that, like, the people, the Trump pirates, have been building this factory and are causing them all kinds of trouble. And Luffy's like, okay, I'm gonna beat him up. There's no reason. The reason Luffy attacked this guy is very vague. He doesn't really have any, like, real reason to do it. Up until the end of the movie where he finishes him off with a typical One Piece reason. But now, but my biggest gripe with this movie would have to be, one, Zoro doesn't get all three swords until the end. When they break into the Trunks Pirate's base, he does take a sword from one of the minions, but he doesn't find another two swords. No, he just uses this one sword the entire movie. But I will say, it is nice to see blood when Zoro cuts somebody. Sanji kicks people, but his foot is always getting damaged. And it's really a stereotypical storytelling. Like, they make their way up a tower, there's a lot of traps. Then there's this part after Sanji gets captured, and the guy apparently wants to crucify Sanji because Sanji made some comments about rubbing sun lotion on Nami's back. Yeah, but the main villain wants to marry Nami for some reason. Well, I can see why, but it's weird. And so he wants to crucify Sanji. So he ties Sanji to a cross and he's gonna crucify him. I'm like, whatever, that's not gonna happen. Especially considering it's an anime movie, not in the manga. But you know, Nami, even then, that's the point when Nami starts kind of becoming concerned. I mean, you know, it's like she had this, like, it appeared that they make Nami out to believe Luffy in this movie. They make her out to be kind of dumb. Because she clearly does not understand how that Luffy is strong, but he's not as. She clearly thinks he's way stronger than he is. Because she's looking at the guy like, Luffy can beat you easy. Then Luffy has a tremendously difficult time beating him. So that bothered me because, you know, it's a statement that contradicts what happened. So that kind of bothered me. But then again, Nami's not really a fighter, so you could argue she wouldn't really understand the power gap very well. I don't know why they even had her say that. It really bothered me. But then, of course, Usopp tries to tell the kid, and the kid is always getting saved by his big brother, Boruto, whatever his name is. And Usopp pretty much had told him earlier that, like, a man that doesn't, like, about, like, how a man needs to have courage and all of this. And so when they're fighting this one guy that has this power to, like, shoot poison out of his butthole. I know, it's really weird. But it like paralyzes you. Usopp fights him off, but gets captured in the process. So then it leads us to just being Luffy and Zoro. What a coincidence. Totally not planned at all. So they arrive in a room, and the guy hits the kid with like a stick or something in the face, knocks him down. And then his brother Boruto stays to that. Ace and Luffy, like, I don't know if Oda had any say in that because he knew without Luffy and Ace's relationship in the future, but it was definitely something you would see with Ace and Luffy. But, so then what happens is Boruto knocks the guys out, and this is the part that gets weird. He takes the kid, and he's like, I wanted you to see Trump, the Trump pirate, because apparently, earlier in the movie, it was revealed that he, Aski, the kid, he didn't have a hometown to return to, but apparently Clockwork Island, Clock Tower Island, whatever it's called, was his hometown, so he wanted it to become freed by the Straw Hat, and there was no indication of why he thought Luffy could beat this guy, but only thing I can think of is because this is post-Arlong Park, and due to the fact that Luffy at that point in time had the highest bounty in the history of the East Blue, with that being 30 million, due to the fact that he took down Buggy with, I think, 10 million, Krieg with like 15 million, and Arlong with 20 million. The Buggy and Krieg bounty could be wrong, but I know Arlong with 20 million. But, so that bothered me a little bit, because there was really no indirect reason why he thought the Straw Hat could take him out, especially when there's only one person on the crew with a bounty. But whatever. Now, so yeah, Luffy, then like the ceiling collapses, and Zoro and Luffy land, so just try to push it up. And this is where it gets annoying, alright? So this guy showed up, apparently him and Zoro know each other. Probably some guy Zoro tried to kill to get some money a couple years back or something. But he throws these like needles at Luffy. Zoro takes the shot on some like Naruto and Sasuke Haku crap, and it's just, and then relatively speaking, what happened is, God, I hate saying this, what happened is Zoro tried to fight him, he loses, and I freaking hate this. Zoro loses to him, which doesn't make any sense. Well, it kind of does, but he was really injured, but still. And then Luffy spent the next like 20 minutes trapped under like the enclosing room, and that was bad, and oh God. And you know, then we just get a lot of stuff up there, and eventually the guy revealed that he goes and used this thing he had called the King Cannon to kill Zoro, Sanji, and Usopp, who were tied to the Crucifixes, and this thing went Nami finally decide to attempt to do something. I have a whole part of this review I'm going to dedicate to Nami in this movie, because hated it. But she tried to do something. She tried to kick him. He just grabs her leg. He throws her, and she's like, and he's like, you're marrying me. I'm the only person that. And she's like, that's not how it works. These are my friends. So then he decides, let's kill the woman too. Complete 180. Before he was this relatively nice guy. Hideous, like. Actually looked like he hadn't bathed in like 5 years, like black beard level dirty, but you know, was really nice to Nami, and now he, out of nowhere, because she cares about her friend, wants to kill her. And let's be honest, the reason he wants to kill Nami and you know, doesn't care about the lies of Nami's friend, is because Luffy needs to fight the guy. So here's a stupid ass reason for them to fight. Because he's actually an asshole, even though he was attempted to be pretty nice throughout the whole movie, but whatever. Then we get into the stuff with Sanji, not with Sanji, with Usopp. So, Luffy and the others, but then the final battle, I guess you could say, where Usopp is probably the most important person in, which I did like. But so, Luffy eventually somehow stretches his arm with enough pressure and high enough up that he actually pushes like the rooms that are like coming and like enclosing in on him up and out of the building. It's a very odd thing to see Luffy doing. Something I don't even know if he could do post time skip. I just don't know if he can physically stretch it in the way he did in this movie. I don't know if he can do that. But whatever. I'll let it slide because it's a movie that took place like before he even fought Crocodile, before Robin joined the crew, so I can let it slide for now. But it's getting weird because Luffy showed up, the brother Boruto had left after Akin, he had taken Akin when he was on concerts, and he had like left Zoro and Luffy in that room. And he had been like, I'm going to take care of them himself. There was this whole thing where he tried to fight the main villain. It was lame. But he had brought the dynamite with him. And apparently the key to the island, never really explained what they meant by that, but the key to the island was there so we couldn't blow up a dynamite. Luffy arrived and of course picked up a dynamite, liked it, liked a piece of it, and then throwed it at the area where all the Straw Hats are being held. But instead of killing them, get this, it somehow destroyed the wooden crucifix without burning them, undone the rope, and gets Zoro and Sanji and Usopp free, but it doesn't undo the rope around Nami's hand. The fact is that he somehow got them down from the crucifix without hurting them is insane and unbelievable as it is. That itself is a problem I have with the movie. It's literally a lot of things that happen, a lot of the physics and things that happen, it don't make realistic or just logical sense. They would never happen. If you're tied to a crucifix and there's a giant explosion right in front of you, the result will not be you get untied from the crucifix and they all are completely destroyed. That's not how it works. That really bothered me. But then, though, relatively speaking, what happens is they all get their fight. Sanji probably gets the coolest fight. Then again, because I love pre-time skip Sanji. Because post-time skip, he kind of just kicks stuff. He's like, I'm going to kick the crap out of things. But, he gets a lot of that old-fashioned, coordinated, hand-to-hand, foot-to-foot, I guess you could say, fighting, where it's like a whole style of martial arts, and it's really cool to see. But then Zoro gets the fight. Usopp got up to where the Merry was, because the Trump Pirates were the ones who stole the Merry. He tosses, he gets his slingshot and takes out the same guy he fought earlier. And then he gives Zoro his doors and Zoro takes out the guy that he fought earlier. Very basic plot. And then Luffy, of course, fights the main villain. The Boruto guy tried to shoot a King Cannon at him. But, then it misses. The main villain takes out the gun, tried to shoot Boruto. The kid jumps in the way and gets shot. Then he throws him out of the window. Somehow, for some reason, the kid had a parachute. Like, I barely even know what happened. This movie was all over the place. The kid had a parachute. I don't know where he got a freaking parachute. I didn't even know there were parachutes in this damn series. But whatever. But the kid floats down. Boruto goes after him. The main villain said something main stereotypical. I'm calling him main villain because he doesn't have a backstory. He's that typical. I don't remember his name. His name was dead like 2 times. I'm not even kidding you. But he insults the kid, called him like a pathetic, weak piece of trash that doesn't deserve to live. Luffy gets pissed off because that's his friend. And then the guy gets in the cannon, fires it at Luffy. Luffy stretches it out, wraps his arms around it, and he goes flying. Like, he stretches farther than I've ever seen him stretch out into the rest of the state, and he snap back and does like a gumu gumu no screw and hits him and sends the guy flying, gets rid of him. Of course, the key to the island is destroyed, all the citizens evacuate. The kids find out some woman they had met earlier in the movie who got like 5 minutes of screen time is actually his mom. There was a small hint at this, but it was still, I didn't really care for it. The kid, I'm reunited with my mother, stereotypical lost boy storyline. That was annoying. And, of course, the Straw Hats then leave, but Boruto is staying on his ship alone. Him and Boruto and, the kid were stealing things together. They were a band of thieves. And the Straw Hats were like, well, you'll be alright on your own. The kid showed up and he's like, you're not on your own, we're brothers. And really, really cheesy, really bad. And so then they're like, okay, whatever. Also, they had this idea to steal this, like, great diamond clock. Yeah, that Nami seemed very interested in the diamond clock as well. That was never really brought up again. Like, the diamond clock thing was kind of just scrapped, like, halfway through the movie, which kind of annoyed me. I think felt like that would be pretty interesting to see something like that, but whatever. So they leave. So the kid and the Boruto leave, and, jolly good, right? The movie's over. Yeah, well, before I end the review, I really want to talk about Nami in this movie, because Dick was just an insult. This movie was literally an insult to the character. And I'll get into why. Okay, so, even Usopp, Sanji, and Zoro were a lot weaker in this movie. So, I'm not saying this is just Nami. All of them were depowered in this movie. Luffy was made out to be way stronger than anybody else on the crew in this movie, which I hated. But Nami in this movie is so freaking useless. I actually had trouble believing Oda would okay having one of the Straw Hats be this freaking useless in a movie. I mean, Nami did nothing in this movie. She did like one. No, actually, no. But there was this one water Logia. Yeah, there was a water Logia in this. Was it? Tell me in the comments how many things are wrong with a water Logia. But she trapped the water Logia in like a jar and then threw this shut. It was just like, what? But okay, whatever. And that was all she did. So she didn't even have a fight. She just trapped a woman that could turn into water in a jar. And that was really annoying. But aside for that, all she really did was sit there. And I would not have been so bothered. I'm not bothered by Nami not being as strong as other people, because this is before she had her climb attack. So I can kind of see her having trouble keeping up with people like Zoro, Sanji, Luffy, and to some degree Usopp, even though I believe Nami has always been stronger than Usopp since day one, because Oda said Usopp's purpose in the story was to be the weakest Straw Hat. But she's not just weaker than them in this movie, it's like she doesn't really care about them. Nami doesn't seem to care about her crewmates in this movie until the plot deems it convenient for her to actually try to help them. Because throughout most of the movie, she doesn't try to help them. Sanji tied to a crucifix, and she just sits there. She's like, oh, Luffy, Luffy's around me, other will handle. I'm like, bitch! I'll blame Nami for this. It was so annoying. Because she didn't even try. Like, at one point she tried to kick the guy in the face. And I'm just like, really? You're trying to kick the guy in the face? I didn't understand Nami's logic here. I felt like it was kind of offensive. But whatever. Nami was useless. Like, people say Sakura for Naruto is useless. This is worse. This is legitimate. At least Sakura cared about the other characters in the series. You know, at least caring about other characters is part of the character. In this movie, Nami just sits there, and it's just pretty much silent, or there for comedic relief that isn't even funny, up until it is convenient for her to be like, oh, let's help Sanji. And it's just really annoying. She also disrespected Luffy a lot in this movie, which I did not like. Like, she just let this guy run his mouth about he was the only one who could be Pirate King. And I don't see any of the Straw Hats taking that. If you said that to any in front of any of them, I think that would piss them off. Nami doesn't seem fazed by this guy pretty much saying Luffy won't be the Pirate King. But whatever, Nami's character would handle terribly. Speaking of that, I did mention Usopp, Zoro, and Sanji were a lot weaker in this movie. They just lost. Like, Usopp and Nami being defeated and captured by the enemy and being, like, tied to a crucifix or something, I can see that happening. But Zoro and Sanji being defeated in combat and being captured, I just don't see that. The only way you could actually beat Zoro or Sanji, in my opinion, is to murder them and to kill them. You would have to kill them. I just don't see Zoro or Sanji ever allowing themselves to be captured. And especially in such a humiliating manner, but you know what, whatever. Compared to the last movie, it's like way better. The reactions are better, it's funnier, I had a couple of good laughs. But there were a lot of times where I was just like, why is this character doing that? Why is this character doing that? Why is he doing that? So, but it's entertaining. If I had to rate this movie, I would say a 3.5 out of 5. I think that's a pretty good rating, a 3.5 out of 5. It's good, but it's not too good. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed. Please like, comment, and subscribe for more One Piece movie reviews. My goal is to review all the One Piece movies and specials before the release of the One Piece film Gold. But guys, remember, above all else, to have a great day. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe for more videos. This is One Piece Nation, signing out.